hamster. So, just when somebody is telling you, fuck life, I'm cynical, life is money, power, blah, blah, just ask him, okay, 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 show me your hamster. Where is your hamster? No, hit him. And that's where interpretation still can do its work. Okay, maybe I will finish for today. There were other things that I wanted to deal with. For example, all the topic of choice, the ideology of choice today. You know how we are always asked to choose. But what I wanted to focus on is the terrorizing dimension of it. In the sense of, what are they really asking to you is disclose your desire. What do you really want? And it always makes you guilty because, as we know for Lacan, the basic situation of a desiring subject is that you don't know what you desire. So I think this is superego, this apparent freedom to choose. You know, somebody, I tried to reserve an upper class, because others were paying for it, hotel in the United States, my God, soft or hard blankets, big or small, what do you call it, pillow and so on, all the choice, my God. And this is very actual today when you have this big debate in the United States about healthcare. How? The whole healthcare debate on the right, those who oppose Obama, is they precisely mobilize the idea that somehow this will deprive you of the choice and so on if we discard those freaks like, and then maybe this can be the first step towards Hegel, Sarah Palin. You remember when she said Obama is evil, that this plan is evil, referring to those death panels or whatever, no? But I think that this is a perfect illustration, Sarah Palin here, of what Hegel meant. You remember, in Phenomenology, towards the end, when Hegel describes the beautiful soul, towards the end of the chapter on spirit, where Hegel says that that evil often resides in the very gaze which perceives evil, everything around. That's the clear case of her, the gaze itself which sees evil is evil. And okay, but I want to do, if you want, so, answering to popular appeal, would you agree then that tomorrow we say, fuck off with these boring popular examples and do a little bit of Hegel?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, we do it. What did you want to?
We had this discussion the other day about whether the Fed is in the old Marxian sense, and generally sublimation is in the end the enemy.
Is
in the end the enemy, whether what we really want is quantized and not ideology. In the sense of,
like
an idea of the proletariat, for example, or whether we need a new idea, whether we need to sublimate it, whether we need to put something else in its place.
No, I'm
a goal in a sense.
Yeah, but I'm more positive towards sublimation. I will tell you why. Let me go again. Sorry, old sexist. To love. I claim the key insight from Lacan is that first, sublimation has nothing to do with idealization or desexualization. Sublimation for Lacan is something totally different. It's as Lacan puts it, you put an empirical object which is in this way sublimated at the position of thus being the thing. But what does this mean? For example, let me be very vulgar. Let's say you are in love with a man, a woman, whatever. True love has no need to idealize the partner. True love is not, I ignore your bad sides. True love is to accept you fully as you are, and as such you are the absolute object, and so on. While idealization needs to, you know, erase all, which is why, for example, we can endlessly talk about it, you know, so of course Hitchcock's Vertigo. It's absolutely not love. The only one who really loves is she, Kim Novak, Judy, the poor girl, loves him. Her love is precisely, for his love for her is precisely idealization. You remember how he dresses her up as the lost Madeleine and so on and so on. That's not love. Love doesn't need this, which is why one of the most reactionary myths that I read is an old myth about a Christian morality short story I read in a religious journal once on an airplane about a guy who was wounded, temporarily blind, and fell in love with the nurse who spoke to him, with such a, who was taking care of him. Then, at the end of the cure, when he was able to see again, he noticed that this woman is really very ugly. So what he did is that he blinded himself again to be able to love her. I think this wasn't true love. True love, you don't need, you absolutely don't need idea. What you also don't need as idealization is the one who was here years ago, I think, you know, the art pornographic French lady, Catherine Breillat. In one of her films, he has this scene, which is a nice fantasy, but I don't think it's love, when sex is done like this, that the woman is like divided here in the sense of she's leaning forwards and there's a kind of a hole in the wooden wall so that up here she's nice talking with a friend, gently holding hand. Below the other part she's screwed in, penetrated. You know, this idea of precisely this division, you don't need to do it in sublimation. Sublimation is something very interesting. It has absolutely nothing to do with, again, for Lacan, with de-sexualization.
But as a political category, in the sense of a direction, or a Platonist even idea.
Okay, here that would involve us into other topic. What I don't think this is sublimation, like usually they say Stalinist leaders, you know, I always like it. No, for me the true sublimation is, but we will not have time to go into it, the ultimate sublimation would be the best, you all know it. But did you think what a strange image it is? The best known painting from French Revolution, you know, Jean-Louis David, The Death of Marat. Did you notice what a strange image is this? Look at the painting. It's just the lower third, more than half of the painting is just darkness. And it's wonderful, this oppressive darkness. What it is? Because if Marat were to be already a socialist realist painter, he would have probably filled in this darkness with something like the noble dream of the dying Marat, happy French people dancing. It's nothing, it's just the void. This painting itself is for me a proof for Jacobins, that Jacobins were not yet totalitarians or whatever, that they were absolutely good guys, and so on, and so on. Sorry, so let's stop. So, okay, tomorrow we go to Hegel. I promise you.